Okay, we are recording. So welcome everybody at our second DMG seminar. Yizhaq very kindly and thankfully accepted that the last instant to fill the gap, because we had a speaker that unfortunately he could he canceled, and he will give in the second semester, but and we are looking forward for him. But in any case, we are very happy that that Yizhaq came. So Dr. Yizhaq Makovsky, he did his master degree at Tel Aviv University in the geophysical department, then a PhD in Stanford in 1997, moved for a postdoc to Europe in Barcelona in the CSIC. And after that, he did 10 years in Paradigm in a company. And from there, he around 2010, he joined Sviven Avram and Uishakno and established the Department of Marine Geosciences, our own department. Since then, he's managing the lab, Amel, who you probably know. I will request, please, to whoever is unmuted to mute. and he's teaching many of our courses the department. So with these few words, Yizhaq, I leave you the podium for the talk. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Hi, everyone. I did the mistake of saying yes to Nicholas while moving my house. He has a good timing of asking, so here I am. I apologize for not getting to the hybrid room because it was just too much here. I'm all with boxes and things because we just moved. But I think that we can deal like that. So what I'm going to talk about today is basically a certain aspect of our research that we've been holding for the last decade. Two little corrections. Arrived to Haifa 2007, not 10, and did a bachelor degree at Tel Aviv, not master's, but more or less okay. What I'm going to do today is discuss a certain aspect of a very big project that we've been running over the last decade in very broad collaboration. And this slide partly presents the scope of collaboration of this project. And I'm sure I've been forgetting and I have been underlisting people that are important and that take important part in this evolving project. And recently we have acquired a few more partners which are not yet involved in this part, but will be involved in, I hope, in subsequent coming presentations. So it's really about the behavior of modern submarine. Being a co-host is a bothering thing. This is really about discussing the role of modern submarine canyons and fan systems in the world, and we must understand that the deep ocean, in a way, is secluded from the climate, or from the weather, by separated from the shallow water and secluded from weather changes. And for climate to change, this seclusion has to be broken. There must be a leakage of the weather, evolving weather conditions, to the deep water, and this is in a big picture. But in some places in the world, there are linkages that directly tap outside a climate into the deep water, and these and some of those places are the big deltas and funds of river systems. Yes, and you can see here some of the river systems of the global river systems, and you can see that they can span thousands, hundreds to thousands of kilometers into the deep sea. When we come closer to the Eastern Mediterranean, this is the eastern part or the eastern part of the Nile fund, of the Nile outpour fund. And there are two modes in which this fund is being expressed in the structure or in the morphology of the seafloor in our area. On one side is the direct outpour or the result of direct outpour of the Nile directly to the deep sea, forming the deep sea fan of the Nile. And in the offshore of Israel, this is the yellow zone here that is composed of a intertwined network of channels, of seafloor channels. The other way that the Nile affects our region is through a bypass, a sedimentary bypass that in fact evolved to, or a has been responsible for the evolving wedge or a sedimentary wedge that formed the Israeli continental margin. Yes. Now, I refer you to Shatner and Shatner and Lazar's papers to look at more details on how this happens. I will only mention that all of this is happening on top of the Messinian evaporites, basically a layer of Messinian of evaporites that they accumulated here through constraint of the Gibraltar Straits. And I will direct you to Ari Melichson's paper on that and some other paper and many other papers that have been written on that. So we have a wedge from the continental margin of Israel, a bigger wedge coming from Egypt, and all of this is moving over the evaporites that are being pushed back and forth and deforming. Now, our work was really based in a great deal on an effort that has been done over the last more than a decade in mapping the offshore of Israel. And it starts from the masters of Roni Sadeh, goes through Zohar Gwirtzman that accumulated seismic data and used seismic data and some of the work of the Israeli Oceanographic and Limnological Research Institute, and created a preliminary map, and then a better multi-beam map, which can I refer you to Canary's paper 2020, which actually now reveal a lot of detail and allow us to explore the seafloor. The most of the work that's been done has been done through a series of cruises, with the pioneering set of cruises being the Nautilus cruises led by Tzvi Ben Avraham, Bob Ballard, Jamie Austin, Dwight Coleman, and myself. And then in a couple of weeks, we sort of touched some areas of the Israeli offshore, dived into some areas of the Israeli offshore with those ROVs, remotely operated vehicles that could dive, photograph, and manipulate, sample the seafloor at great depths. And we then discovered how much we didn't know. It was followed by the SEMSIT project with a cruise that was that took place in 2016 into the area of Palmachim disturbance and further into the Israeli offshore, bring a slew of sampling methodologies and an ROV into the work. And later on, with cruises, series of cruises, this is being the first one, but series of cruises on the research vessel, Bat Galim, that, there is some construction just outside my window, that with this new research vessel, or newly renovated research vessel and new facilities existing on top of it with a great piston core, box cores, and our new ROV and AUV, we managed to expand our work in a significant manner. And I think one of the big contribution was to the mapping by AUV of the seafloor. And so in 2010, we discovered this coral garden offshore Israel at 600 to 800 meters. And so that the rocks that the corals are growing on are a carbonates or autogenic carbonates. We then in 2011 discovered gas seepage further in the offshore and sampled and actually verified that methane is seeping here from the seafloor, and this is associated with a slew of phenomena, as well with a distinct geophysical signal of very high reflectivity, seismic reflectivity, and with seafloor pockmarks. And you can see this high reflectivity here at the base of a pockmark, where that previous picture was taken from, and you can see series of pockmarks that were sampled by us. One other thing that was important that we realized following these cruises, and this is, you know, Ded Ezra's MSc thesis, is that there is seafloor bioturbation, or say seafloor disturbance, that is associated with the gas seepage. And what Oded did is show that there is a intensification of this bioturbation or this disruption of the seafloor as we get close to the foci of seepage in the pockmarks. So we have this bioturbation, we call it bioturbation, maybe it's not the correct term, but this is seafloor disruptions. In fact, burrowing, as we can see. Later cruises, same ship and follow-up cruises, revealed that this disruption is associated with intense burrowing of the subsea floor to tens of centimeters, and revealed this main, probably the main responsible for the seepage, this blind shrimp that is living at environments that are associated somehow with the seepage. We're still not sure how exactly. And recently we've been looking into that in detail together with Max Rubin-Bloom and the new team and an additional team. And they think that this shrimp actually has an important role in cultivating its own habitat. So now that we've got the background, let's dip deeper a little bit into the deep sea fan of the Nile and look what we can see in the deep sea fan of the Nile. And what we see when we look at the bathymetry in the deep sea fan of the Nile, we see seafloor that is generally smooth, bent by those ridges, which are associated with the formation of the sediments on top of the salt, moving on top of the salt. And then there are distinct seafloor channels, about hundreds of meters wide, tens of meters deep, that are running from the fan, from the delta towards the deeps of Cyprus. Yes, but very distinct channel levi systems. When we look at seismic data that was acquired across the same area, we discover that there is high amplitude reflectivity that is associated with the seafloor. And when, and this is Lawal's Muedin Lawal's PhD thesis, when we go and map this system, we found a very distinct or very widespread system of channel levis note that this map here on the left basically maps the depths with respect to the seafloor of this reflectivity that we see here in the seismic section. So it's a buried system of lobes and channels that is now sealed and buried and overlaid by the modern system. So left, modern system, right, paleo system. Now, when we look at the broad scale of the Nile fan, we see that this buried system is extensive and spread over many of the much of the area. So being an extensive system, we can attribute it to major changes that occur in the Nile outpour of the sediments, which is the common control for all these systems. Yes, and indeed, when we look, this is from Aper and Zhao and all 2021, when we look at the rate of terrigenous flux that is that was as analyzed from a core in the right in front of the Nile Delta, we see that this terrigenous flux comes in pulses and then quiet, and then another pulse and quiet, etc. So what we see here probably represents a big pulse of sedimentation flooding the fan itself and pervasively. And then once the pulse settles down, we shrink back into the modern system, which is more focused. You can see that this buried system is much more pervasive. For example, at this point here, you see here on the seafloor, you see a ridge. Yes, and you can see this channel here actually flew through the ridge, which is of course impossible nowadays. So in fact, what happens is what we interpret to have happened is that the entire fan was overflooded with these sediments that were covering some of the ridges, parts of the ridges here. The dark spots are the leftovers of the ridges that remained. And then once the sedimentation die out, the ridges continue to deform and actually rise up and reform, plugging the system again and forcing the channels to find their own passages through that through those ridges. Okay. Now, we believe since this this whole system has got a very high reflection amplitude, seismic reflection amplitude, we hypothesize that this entire system may be gas bearing, maybe a gas bearing interval. If that is correct, then everywhere that we will somehow cut into this system will be exposed, we should find, in fact, the gas seeping out. And a good example we found in this area here of the fan, which I will expand. In this area, the same, this is this RGB technology, we found a light up of the RGB, meaning that the deep system is coming close to the surface. And when we looked at the seismic data, we saw that there is a bending of this entire system upwards, and it forms a big pockmarks. And when we went there to dive in the same SIPS project, we found in this area a gas seepage environment with the associated biota carbonates. We didn't see bubbles, but the presence of the marine biota clearly indicates that there is a contribution of methane to the surface, that there is seepage going on. This image takes a different look into the evolution of that system of this pockmark, which we will call the Gal C pockmark, mega pockmark, because it is in exploration book, Gal C, for lack of another name. So what we see here is the bathymetry of that ridge. And what we see here is a RGB composition of amplitude extractions of three different horizons or three different levels of the subsurface. And what we see is that these different levels actually show us an evolution of a system. First, there was this flooding by pervasive fans. You see the pervasive fan that is flooding this entire thing, including the ridge itself. Then sediment went down, and we see a channel that is actually running from here and cutting across the ridge. So the ridge was not on the surface. The channel could go across the ridge. And then at some point, the ridge started rising up and the channels needed to find new paths like this and here, which even they are now being deformed in present. So maybe they are not even active today. Now, as the ridge rose up again, what happened is that all these subsurface features started folding up with it, constituting a passage or allowing the passage of gas upwards, and it's focusing at the top of the ridge, and eventually a breakout occurs and the gas seeps out, as is indicated here by this pink color. So this is the interpretation that we have. Phase one, flooding of the area. Those are those two fans, for example. Then reducing of sediment supply and formation of channels that are going across the ridge. Then elevation of the ridge, forcing the channels to overtake it from the side and focusing gas seepage onto the rest of the ridge. In Ziv Tiber's master thesis, which is now published in Tiber et al. 2019, we looked at the very same signal in another perspective. We went and mapped all the highly reflective signal that we find in the top hundreds of meters of the Israeli offshore. And what we found is that the high reflectivity marks two branches, two big branches. One branch that is sub-parallel to the seafloor, tens of meters beneath the seafloor, and that is that branch of reflectivity. And what we're seeing here is the distribution of high amplitude reflectivity in the seismic data that we had as a function of water depth and as a function of depth beneath the seafloor. Yes? And red colors mean more reflectivity, blue colors means less. So we see here highly distributed branch of reflectivity, which actually depicts the sub-seafloor paleo channel lobe system, pervasive over the entire area. And then we found another branch going down. And when we modeled possible hydrate stability curves, we see that reasonable hydrate stability curves actually match this other branch very well. And so it might be that what we're seeing here is an evidence to the presence of hydrates at depths greater than 1300 meters beneath the seafloor in the eastern sub-eastern Mediterranean. And for more detail, I refer you to Ziv's paper. Let's go to the continental margin of Israel. A few years ago, the word came out that there are worms, in little pockmarks in the Israeli, in the base of the Israeli slope. And this is what it looks like. And this project was done in partnership with a Leviathan partnership which brought the data. And what you see here is the bathymetric shading showing the trace of an active, of a recently active seafloor fault, and near it, multiple pockmarks. When we look at the evidence, and here are some pictures from an ROV, you can see gas bubbles and worms at these pockmarks, bioturbation, and taking all data together, we actually did a mapping effort, which actually mapped the density, since there were clusters of these pockmarks and many, many pockmarks in the cluster. What we did is we actually mapped the percent coverage of pockmarks within a grid size and found that they are extremely prevalent at the base of the Israeli slope. Then when we looked, and what you see, all those colored dots, what you see is the shading of bathymetry at the base of the Israeli slope. In blue, you see traces of faults. And in red colors, you see the concentration of those pockmarks. Additional evidence to the presence of such pockmarks further to the north from where these data showed was brought recently by a first cruise of the AUV, of our AUV, looking at the pockmarks with high resolution bathymetry, sub-bottom profiling, and synthetic aperture sonar, which gives us an image of the seafloor at at 3 centimeter resolution. Yes, and we find a multiple of those little pockmark clusters across the area again. Looking at the distribution of these pockmarks, and what you see here is a seismic section. This is the seafloor. This is depth beneath the seafloor, a few hundred meters beneath the seafloor. The vertical stripes are the places where you have pockmarks on the surface. And what we find is that the pockmarks on the surface are nicely associated with breaches of highly reflective intervals in the subsurface. So look, for example, here you see a reflective interval, you see a fault. That reflective interval is breached. Above this breaching point, you have seafloor seepage. So deep breaching of gas-bearing intervals at the base of the Israeli continental margin brings up seepage. And the way we understand that is another gas system, different than what I showed in the deep sea fan, which is associated with accumulation of sediments as the salt retreats from the margin and sediments are supplied along the margin and accumulate. They cause the salt to retreat and they form sort of a mini basin or a set of mini basins. And in that setting, we get the formation of gas bearing layers. And now we go back to where we started, Palmachim disturbance. Palmachim disturbance is a broad, a ongoing mass transport a complex, which looks like a rotational slide, as you see here, extension up here. This all part here is a slab that was detached from here, that is being detached from here, and continuously over millions of years moves down, and then a collision at the toe with the sediments at the bottom. Yes, and I won't go into the details, but this very unusual structure about 15 kilometers wide and 50 kilometers long has proved to comprise and to be associated with multiple phenomena justifying the naming that was wisely given to it by Garfunkel in 1997, the first person to have mapped it. Palmachim disturbance. Maybe it disturbs you, the name disturbance, but calling it a slide or something like that, or a mass transport feature, is too little for this feature. It's way more complicated. It's way more complex than that. Now, gas seepage, modern gas seepage concentrates at the western edge of this disturbance down here in those ridges and along the Levant channel here. Yes, and particularly these three ridges were investigated already by the by the Nautilus cruisers. Lawal Muedin, and I'm sorry, this is not labeled, but this is from Lawal Muedin's PhD. Instead, or in spite of me telling him that this is probably not correct, has shown me that in fact there are two alternative and possibly coexisting processes that supply gas to the pockmarks. These are the pockmarks, and this is the Levant channel where we found more gas, to the pockmarks and Levant channel in Palmachim. One is this gas-bearing interval, shallow gas-bearing interval that I showed you before. Another one is the focusing, the possible focusing, excuse me, of gas to the edge of those, to the tops of the faults at the collision zone at the toe of the Palmachim disturbance, and their migration directly up to the seepage point. And the way he showed it is that he examined the amplitude on different horizons. Basically, here there is a big MTD horizon. He looked at the bottom of this MTD and mapping the amplitudes at the bottom of this MTD. Yes, what we see is that there are concentration of high amplitudes directly beneath where we have the seepage edifice at the surface. So possibly there is migration of gas directly up on the top of those ridges, again, like we saw in the continental margin of Israel, not along the faults, but on the crests of the faults, where there is a potential for the, where there is a push. Yes? So he has shown that there is another yet a process that brings us gas from the top, and this idea of his just recently got a very interesting verification. And he's looked at the very at the base of those pockmarks and shown that the seepage is associated actually with fracturing that occurs in the near subsurface, yes, just below the seafloor, because of the or in association with this folding that is associated with deforming on the salt. So all this deformation forms another way for gas to seep and reach the surface and form those pockmarks. So there is another pathway. But regardless, taking the same attitude of a multi-horizon amplitude extraction, which has shown us the nice fans in the Nile, the nice channel lobe systems in the Nile Valley, is we found it to be very useful in identifying potential gas seepage zones. And in fact, when you do that, you see that areas that we have found to be gas seepage related light up with bright colors, like here and here. These sites were found to be associated with gas seepage during the Nautilus cruises. And in 2016, we tried this this concept the first time, and that's how we found seepage sites along the Levant channel on the top, Levant channel being the seafloor channel of the Nile deep sea fan that is the easternmost deep sea channel of the Levant, of the Nile deep sea fan, passing just below the Palmachim disturbance, okay? So we found a way to map seepage that predicts the locations, the location of seepage points, and we have a first verification of that here and in the Kalsi a pockmark. So we went another step, and Lawal went and used this same attitude to map seepage sites across the entire western part of Palmachim disturbance. And this here is the edge of the Palmachim. Those are the ridges. These are the three ridges that were investigated by the Nautilus. These are the other ridges. And here is Levant channel that is passing down here. Yes, the deep sea channel that is passing down here. And he went and pinpoint places where he would expect seepage to occur based on the concept of the buried paleosystems in the subsea surface or buried reflectivity. He did more than that and also graded them to low, to inactive, low, moderate, and high potential gas seepage based on the on how clear the signal was, like those yellow dots, yellow areas got high, and those places where the, that were indistinct got low. And this is here also mapping the areas that are associated. Taking all these, we were approached by the Israeli Nature Protection Authority to create a model of a seafloor rare habitats. And we collected, and so we collected observations over the last decade, and I will make it short, and registered, co-registered, and this is a work done by Adi Neumann. We collected them into a common database, then quantified the different observations based on the a probability that they are associated with gas seepage. We then weighted our distribution by the presence of bathymetric complexity using an attribute that we calculated that we call bathymetric complexity power. I don't have the time to explain it. And created a model for the presence of rare habitats at the seafloor. And this model was reported and is now focusing some debate with respect to the potential declaration of the first marine protected area in deep water outside the territorial boundary of Israel. Okay, and these are the different zones that were mapped, the area of the corals, the area of the gas. But both the geophysical methodology and the modeling of rare habitats required verification. Yes, this is the model. Both the model and the idea of the geophysical mapping required verification, and then we turned to our AUV. And we did an AUV survey along the different points picked by Lawal and across different regions of this a model which is depicted here in color. So in blue is the route of the AUV survey. And the color scale, the scalar scheme shows the model. And over here, where Lawal specified high unconfirmed seepage, we found this. What you're seeing here is a backscatter image of the seafloor. And the different at a resolution of 3 centimeters as acquired by the AUV. The AUV is going perpendicular to those lines along the route going on the left upper side of the screen and we, and looks looking sideways, creating those images. What we see here is the seafloor that is just a seafloor that is indistinct. Then we see bioturbation here in mounds and in disturbances on that seafloor. Then we see carbonate rocks, rocks which clearly are carbonate because all that's all the rocks we found so far. Yes. And these are more rocks. And then we found this stuff, this thing. And I, what it looks like are two poles or pools at the seafloor, And we found those stripes, which indicate the presence of bubbles rising from the seafloor up towards the AUV. So that was a very curious feature. And so doing a collaborative project, we went to dive there. We utilized a University of Haifa CI ROV, we now call Jonah, and we fit it up with various samplers, like this gas sampler from Bremen, sediment cores, scoops, the arm, etc. And we went, and right over here, we found this. And this is a pool of water at the seafloor. And here I think I will cut the presentation and show you short and show you a couple of movie flicks. Since I don't have much time. Oops, what is this? This is not the movie flick I wanted. Sorry. This is the one I wanted. And what you're seeing here is a picture on the of the ROV as it's approaching this pool. And what you see is that this shark over here coming, it will come back in a minute, dive into the pool, disappear, and come out. So there is a pool of water here on the seafloor. What you see here is a bundle of worms, of cube worms. Now we're going to sample, we're going to go in and sample the water of the pool, and you see we're getting into it, and you can see there is clearly a density difference. And here the Niskin bottle is in the pool, and we are going to trigger it. Click, we just sampled water. We then went on and sampled sediments on the bank of the pool. Here we are sampling sediments. And all the time those sharks are coming by. Here is the sediment that came out. And then we went on, and you can see on the seafloor those little pools. They look like the sinkholes of the Dead Sea with different water, with different water. And all this white stuff, white snow that you see around us are all bacteria. And look here in the hole, you see those things? They are like shell looking things inside the hole, and gas just bubbled out of this pool. So we went ahead and sampled this gas. You see here the bubble accumulating from the seepage in the hole. Here just a few more bubbles were added in. So that was one thing. And then what we see here is a stretch of region dotted with those white things. And when we get closer to that, we found that this broad region is all an area covered by tube worms, by an overgrowth of tube worms and multiple fauna in between. And those things, and looking at their distinct morphology, we found out that they are what people call mermaid's purse. They are the eggs of sharks. And in fact, I don't show you here, we could see even the embryos inside. What we see here is a spring of water running out of the seafloor and trickling down the seafloor, yes? And all the white stuff is bacteria. And you see again, those mermaid purses, the the eggs of the shark. You can, if you look good, you can see the water are trickling, that they are actually flowing here in this little spring on the seafloor. And we believe that these are the sources of the salty water that is accumulated in the ponds. And of course, we find plastic, even there, shamefully. Here is a travel along, but the other one, this is the bigger pool. And what we are doing is we're going along the banks of this pool. On the left, you see something. And on the right, you see the bank. And I can tell you that this is a salty water, probably higher density, saltier, a little bit warmer water. Barak Heru tells me I shouldn't be calling it a brine, but let's say for a popular definition, we can call it brine. And then comes out the picture that really captured the world media, and that's this picture. All the brown you see on the seafloor are those shark eggs. And you see sea urchins, which it's a good question what they're doing there, but maybe they're eating the sharks, the sea urchins. And this is a sentence that comes from Maxim Rubin-Bloom, raising this idea. And what you see all these white dots are the eyes of mock sharks. Inside the away from the light circle of the ROV. And these are different sharks. The common ones are the blackmouth catfish, blackmouth cat shark, while this thing is probably eating, is a predator that is preying on the eggs. I think we can see that in a later part of the movie. Sorry, here you can see it actually eating eggs. So this discovery actually verifies the idea of Lawal, because what we're seeing here is evidence for a deep source of the seepage. And it's an opening of a new era for us, which you will hear about in a subsequent seminar. I think that this is when I have to stop, so I won't show you more at the moment. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Itik. Excellent talk and absolutely amazing data. Okay, so I opened the podium for questions virtually and from the people in the class. Since I don't see all faces, please just jump in.
I have a little question right now. So as you told in the very end, that seepage is in this little basin hole stuff. So it differs from a classical seepage model, where seepage is kind of on the top of curvy layer, like in a dome. But now we have an opposite situation, right? Or did I understand it wrong?
Well, you need to separate the building of the potential from its representation on the seafloor. On the seafloor, many times seepage occurs within pockmarks. So finding the seepage in a hole is the common thing, probably the hole being formed by the seepage itself. Yes, what you're talking about, these high potential locations, is where the source of the seeping fluid should come from. There should be a sort of a trap kind of a feature at the subsea floor, whether it's a layer that is extending out to the seafloor, or a fold, or a broken feature, that gives us a place of high potential, a point of high potential from which the seepage will come out. Yes? So the source, or maybe not the source, the complete source of the fluid, but the latest focus from which the seepage is originating has to be having the potential on the seafloor. What evolves are our holes and pools and all this kind of stuff.
Okay, and another one, a little bit of moral question. Will your discovery lead to ecological fight for limiting oil and gas exploration in those areas?
I just said it, that right now, this model that I showed is a model that is being used as an argument for establishing a marine protected area over this zone. Yes, we are. Our findings are nowadays at the focus of discussion for declaration of conservation. Yes.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Marina.
Yeah. I have a question.
Go ahead.
Yeah, Izzy, nice presentation. It's actually amazing to see something like look like a caldera within a marine environment. So, and I was wondering, where you show the pool of water, like a pond of water within the sea floor. I'm wondering if it's also as a result of the pore map formation or as a result of something else.
Well, you need to form a pool. So something formed a hole. We can see, and like I said, it is very common for a seepage to form holes at the bottom of the sea. Yes, so the hole, the formation of the hole would be associated in some way or the other to the seepage. It could be that the seepage actually pushes away sediment and not letting it settle and forming the hole. It could be actually excavating the hole. There could be an explosion feature. There are different theories that come up in literature, and it could be a collapse feature that is associated with the seepage. All of those models are being raised by the in the literature. Here, I think that it is really we still are not completely clear, but I think it's an excavation type of thing. The seepage actually pushes the sediment out of that area, not letting new sediment settle and actually digging out a hole. Then the accumulation of the water, we have water with high density, so they are heavier than the water of the sea coming out of the seafloor. And these waters, since they are heavier, flow on the seafloor itself to the lowest place, just like water would do in the outer, in the terrestrial environment. So they flow and they pond in holes. So I think this is the process that created this.
Thank you. More questions?
I'm amazed to see the chair of Dr. John K. Hall, a very distinguished chair. Any more questions?
We have one question from here.
Yes.
Hello. When we looked at the footage of the mudslide in Palmachin, so to the north of it, about 30 kilometers, there's a high accumulation of mud. It looks like also a mountain or so, from what I saw. Is there any scientific interest in this accumulation that I saw there?
I'm not sure what you're talking about.
The picture of the bathymetry of the mudslide with the high resolution.
First of all, calling it a mudslide is a complete degradation. Let's call it a mass transport feature. You cannot imagine it even as a mud A mudslide is this kind of stuff. You see here a scar, and you see here an outlet. You see here a lobe. This is what mudslides look like. Mm-hmm. Yes. This is a bigger feature. It's actually hundreds of meters thick, and it's coherent. It doesn't just slump. It's coherent. It's moving coherently or semi-coherently. Now, can you direct me?
And just like 40, 30 kilometers to the north.
This is the topic of a whole different talk, if we want. This is what we call the door distort. It's kind of a simile in terms of origin, in terms of setting. It is a bit similar to the Palmachin disturbance, in which it is associated with the formation on top of an extension of salt towards the margin, and now the place that is underlain by salt is collapsing. Here too, this is probably what is happening. The shape of it is different and more complex, but you can see extensional zone, and you can see a sort of a accumulation zone. We have a master student that is finishing, that has finished, in fact, needs to getting examined in Balifshitz, that is her master thesis on this feature. And this is a feature that naturally focuses much attention, because we have now gas systems, gas pipes that are going up here to the Israeli coast. But it's also a very complexing or perplexing feature, the door disturbance.
Okay, thank you, Itzik. More questions?
I have one question. Thank you very much for the talk. Have you noticed in these habitats that are associated with the pockmarks, have you noticed any stages of development that could be correlated with how long the gas has been seeping from these pockmarks? Mm.
This is a good question. And remember that I showed you in the movie that there are the shell-like things inside the little hole?
Yes.
Later on, I didn't say it, but later on we saw the extracts. And in fact, what you saw inside that seepage place, you saw egg sharks that are tens of centimeters in the sediment, maybe. That already gives us some indication. We have a whole work that I haven't yet mentioned that focuses the PhD of Reinhard Weidlich. He's here at one of the windows, doing the geochemical mineralogical analysis of the carbonates, and our colleagues Tian Yu and this group in China, which are associated with investigating the evolution. Of course, or Bialik, Annelien Foubert, which is focused on investigating the evolution of seepage. Yes, and the preliminary results shows us that one of the carbonates that we found at the earlier stages, pockmarks, one of them gave an age of 10,000 years, but it is one age of one carbonate. It's very little to build on.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, more questions?
I have only a short one. Do you have already data from these more salty waters from these pools, in terms of salinity, temperature, or the chemical?
Well, preliminary results, as reported by Barak, which is now on the phone, it's 42. The salinity is 42.
Okay.
And the temperature is, I think, just under a degree higher. But this is a very preliminary result. We are not sure. And this is sampling the pool, which we are not sure that this is the origin of the water. Maybe this is where they accumulate. Maybe at origin, they will be saltier and hotter. We don't know yet. It's really a very, I didn't discuss many of the results. There are many results. You should have been in the meeting last week, and we will do a better meeting soon. There are many results coming out of those of the last excavation, last cruise.
Yeah,
and we are heading for another cruise in a month.
Yeah, I heard. It's good. Yeah, thanks.
Okay.
Also have one more question, if it's possible.
Please go ahead.
Have you checked also the push course already? If there's a difference between the Levant channel and the older pockmarks to the ones in those brine pools? Or not yet?
It's a great question. Yes. Gilad Antler has already done some analysis of those push cores and has already provided it is full. There is a lot more sulfur and methane here. A lot more. It's a much more rich environment than anywhere that we ran into in the past. Beyond that, except for the push cores that we got in 2010 in the Nautilus cruise was the only push core until now that actually contained methane. Yes. So now we have push cores, water, everything that they're all generally in saturation with respect to methane. So I think this is a big difference to what we've encountered in the past cruise, the SEMSIP cruise.
Well, if there are no more further questions, I think we should stop because it's already a little bit late. Again, thank you very much, Itzik. It is really, really, really interesting. And you know, I am reserving a space next month's cruise. You know that.
Yes.
Okay.
Look at the other windows. People are laughing.
I know that the list is long.
The vessel anyway, is small, that's the problem.
Yeah, that's the problem when the findings are so amazing, I guess.
Yes.
So, thank you everybody. And next week we meet again. We will have a speaker from United States, okay? If he doesn't cancel. Thank you everybody. See you next week.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Thanks.
Bye. See you. Bye-bye.
Hmm.